Okay, Hawaii, it's time to commute and communicate. Join the conversation on Hawaii's award-winning talk program. It's the Mike Buck Show, right here on AM 690 and FM 94.3. The Answer.
Oh, boy, you know, it's kind of interesting. It's called Blurred Lines. And it's kind of funny because sometimes the lines do get blurred until you know what's going on. And what's going on in the world of missile defense is unbelievable. It's been a while since we've had Riki Ellison from the Missile Defense Advocacy Alliance in the studio. Not because of not being around here, but he's been busy. He's got more miles than a pilot. Anyway, it is sort of interesting. You may have seen the headline of this morning's paper. We had already set up this little session with Riki prior to this, but boy, you talk about icing on the cake. It's a big blow for a lot of people who are counting on the radar installation here in Hawaii to be not just, you know, accepted, but enhanced and improved. Well, if you saw the headline of the paper, and it's a little bit misleading, you're going to find out what's going on here. It says, budget drops 1.9 billion radar. And you think, oh, woe is me, where's a building I can jump off? Well, it's not to that point, but it is kind of a little bit spooky. And to help us with that, we've got Riki Ellison in the studio bright and early. He's one of my early guests because, well, I mean, he gets up at 4 when he's here anyway, so it's not as though we have, you know. And he's getting a nice fresh cup of 7-Eleven coffee. So good morning, my friend. Welcome to your second home, man. Since the last time we spoke, we've had the big change up at University of Hawaii. Rolo went on to great things, which we're loving about. We got a new coach. The YIP project, which we're going to talk about later, is going to be going forward. That must make you very happy on that front.
Absolutely. Yeah. So we confirmed that yesterday with the new coach, Todd Graham. We're excited to bring that program back to Honolulu, and I think we're going to go to one of the islands this year and pull the kids from the islands as well.
That's wonderful. And before we do that, please help us lick our wounds just a little bit, because as you know, on Super Bowl Sunday we didn't have a good day. We just didn't have a very good day. It looked good for a while.
Well, it looked great. The highest point of it was that interception that the 49ers had at the third quarter. And that was the peak of our energy. And the offense didn't convert. And then there was doubt that started to linger. Yeah. And Patrick Mahomes took the game over.
Well, he's got that rep of being able to come from behind. I mean, isn't that something? That's another thing.
Well, he's got the mojo. He's got the gravitas. Absolutely. He's got the presence, the command, that great
cool quarterback. Cool as can be.
Can control that game.
And by the way, let's talk about for a minute. Role model. I mean, you know, he's clean and squeaky clean and just this good-looking young guy. The spots that he's doing on television, the news, you know, the insurance company and all that stuff, it's all great. But the bottom line is, this guy plays from behind. He knows how to do that.
Well, and he picked out our slowest corner, which was Richard Sherman. They waited for that play the whole game, and they went after it. But it was a great game. You know, it's hard. Super Bowls are hard to win.
Hey, I was really happy for a big part of that day. And, you know, once you get into that, but then you realize that this guy, he has been trained to come from behind.
But you saw the whole team. It's energy. It's energy management.
It's Mo.
And he was able to change the energy was so high and change it. And then our quarterback, Jimmy G, didn't step up to be a Joe Montana or to be that Patrick Mahomes.
Oh, by the way, speaking about Joe, you know, wasn't it great to see all the guys at the beginning of the game? We got Joe, you know, everybody was there. It was really kind of neat.
It was a special game.
What was it like for you when you won your first Super Bowl ring?
It was invincibility. Yeah. With a bunch of guys, the diversity of our team from all over the country to come together. Yeah. And we were special. It was in San Francisco. Yeah. So I think it's the only home field Super Bowl in
ever.
History.
At that time, period.
But, you know, for us, the game was won before the ball was kicked off. We knew it didn't matter. And then we just took it over. So it was a super special feeling.
You know, these are the good old days for the kids of today, right? I mean, they're going to remember the game, these recent games. We go back to when... Well, it's competitive. Leather helmets and one bar in front of the nose.
Well, the good thing about the NFL, they picked the two best teams. It was competitive.
Yeah.
And that's what you want to watch. You don't want to watch blowouts.
Exactly. And that's the case. All right. Now, like I said, when we first said hello to Riki Gang, first of all, I'm so glad that Riki was going to be in town. It's just coincidence that we got the front page of the paper. But it's more than coincidence. I think all things happen for a reason. And I think people want to know that we've got a lot of people in your milieu are breathing a sigh of relief, because now at least there's been a tremendous amount of funding. And I want you to tell me where we are in missile defense and what this the loss of this radar means to Hawaii.
Okay. So it's historic funding. So the last Monday.
Memorable, right? Yeah.
The president and the administration released the budget, and the budget for missile defense and missile defeat is at $20.3 billion.
Has it ever been anywhere near that before?
Not even close. Not even close, right? Yeah. But the,
what does that tell you? That everybody recognizes
it. It tells you that the threat is real. Yeah. And we saw how Iran used the ballistic missiles earlier this month. But the fact is that we're shifting into an offensive defensive mode to be able to change the calculus and change the investment that Russia and China, that we are most concerned about, especially China in this region. We're changing that dynamic, so they're going to have to be able.
I was going to say they're going to have to be. They're going to have to spend a lot of money.
They're going to have to spend a lot of money. Keep up, because they haven't been, and we haven't put pressure on them to do that. And with creating a system with layers, makes it very difficult for them to build systems to defeat it. So it's a great investment. It's a great push to stabilize everything, because the world today is using ballistic missiles, hypersonic missiles. Yeah. And hypersonic include hypersonic cruise, hypersonic missiles, hypersonic glide, that the technologies are being proliferated around the world. And that's where we're going. So we've got to be ahead of that and stop that.
Well, here's the thing. And I think that a lot of listeners would be on this. And that is simply that the way we do war is way different than it used to be. I mean, look at all the use of drones and things that were just not available in the past. So that all of a sudden makes you realize, all right, there's all kinds of different ways something can be delivered, you know, whether it be...
Well, just let me go to that point, because back in the day, you know, if you're seen, you're killed. So the movement today is now going to be in persistent overhead coverage. They can see everything everywhere at all times, globally and in space. And we're moving into that. So you will always be seen. So these big formations, these big aircraft carrier groups are now going to be seen wherever they're at.
And
they've got weapons now that can take these things out. So we are now shifting a little bit to network versus network, you know, constellation versus constellation in a bigger strategic position.
Yeah, but, you know, in all these years that you've been involved in this, I do know that, you know, We were spending a much smaller part of our defense, our military spending on defense rather than offense. Now it gets to a point where it looks like the administration and the country doesn't want to be as far away as we are in lots of places, wants to really sort of peel themselves backwards, and that means that you have to increase your defense. So it must have been a big sigh of relief of a lot of the programs that you've been, you know, mentoring and massaging for all of these years to be able to stand alone and happen.
We were down to $6 billion a year.
Yeah.
I mean, way less than 2%, 1.5%, 1.25%.
What changed things, man?
Well,
besides you, with your big strong arm and
I think General Mattis made the decision to change our national security away from the Middle East and take on China and Russia as our major threats to our future. And that was the big shift that had to happen. And now we moved our whole strategies now to be building systems and capabilities against them. And China and Russia created new ways of striking the United States. And that propelled that competition that we're in today.
Yeah. And, you know, by the way, it's already been tweeted out that Riki is here. And it's sort of, like I said before, the planets lining up. And it's not as though you go to the with your hands open-handed, spread your hand out, fill his hand. That doesn't mean that all of a sudden this money has increased to a point where it's being sky's the limit. You still have to work and justify and explain and prove everything, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. But we are moving away from limited defensive capability that was built specifically to beat North Korea. We are shifting. So and shifting these technologies to make our country more safe and make our allies more safe in the future.
Rudy just says, is this a la how much money it took to get Star Wars done with Reagan when he finally got the money to do the project? Is this a similar situation, is it?
I think this is
great. That's a great question.
It's a great question. Yeah. This is much more investment this year alone than I think any year, including all the Reagan years, have ever done. And remember, Reagan was more... They were more developing systems And we have current systems today that we are now leveraging the most out of. We are now having some of our smaller systems step up to be able to do ICBM defense. Mm-hmm. And that's what, you know, we're talking about the Navy SM-3 Block 2A missile now that's going to be tested this year to knock down ICBMs. So that adds to the depth of our capability, and certainly that's the missile, I think, that's going to be defending Hawaii.
Well, that's interesting because, you know, back in the day of the Star Wars, I guess the intent then was to have to put stuff up in the sky that would help us, you know, put weapons up there and be having them going around the globe and deployed as needed. Right. It's anything but that now. But like you say, you can almost spot, you know, what some guy's shirt size is on his label from outer space now.
Absolutely. And that's what you have to do because these things are moving so fast, the hypersonic missiles, that you have to track them over a period of time to be able to target them and be able to know where they're going. So the first step, and that's what you're seeing with the Space Force, we developed the Space Force to be able to police space, and we are now putting up constellations of low Earth orbit and medium Earth orbit satellites the size of little tables.
I was going to say, tentacular things.
Hundreds of them, and they're going to go up commercially and military-wise, and they're going to be resilient. So if you take one out, you can put another one back up, and the thing is we're going to connect all these with artificial intelligence
cloud. I'm so happy for you and for all of us because it really, really is encouraging looking. We got plenty more coming up with Riki Ellison from the Missile Defense Advocacy Alliance.
Have you got a question? Want the answer? It's right here and right now. Here's more of the Mike Buck Show on AM 690 and FM 94.3. The Answer.
Yep, the only time I'm not prepared is when I have Riki Ellison in the house. I never know what direction we're going off in. We start off and we always end up talking about football, believe me. We'll have a chance to do that in a bit, but a lot of you woke up to the front page of the Star Advertiser. Budget drops 1.9 billion radar, and everybody panics. Well, you should, because it is a bit of a loss, and I'm not quite sure, because I think, Riki, at the last time we talked, we actually thought that the program was going to be enhanced, that it was going to be made better than it is, and now it looks like that money that looked like coming there is not going to be there. When you jump into this story a little bit and let people know what went on here, what happened, or what didn't happen.
Well, the decision was made with Admiral Harry Harris, I think 4 years ago. And the delegation, the federal delegation here, that the first step to best defending Hawaii was to create a permanent radar that could pick up volumes.
A big installation that can
pick up volumes and raid sizes from North Korea that can give you very discriminating points of where to target. And that was considered the number one priority. We had just finishing the new radar that we built up in Alaska that this would duplicate.
Gotcha. Yeah. And we've often talked about that. We've often talked about who's best protected. Right. And in actual fact, we are the point of the spear closest to where the problems are in Hawaii.
So we went ahead and built the same radar, basically, up in Alaska. And that goes operational, I think, next year or the year after. And it's going to enhance our whole system. So that was the thought of putting it in there.
Gotcha.
And then we started to invest money to be able to move this and pick a site. So they struggled, as you well know, of where the site would be.
Sure.
And they finally came down to the fact that that's probably the best now at PRMF in Hawaii. And that was like a couple weeks ago. Mm-hmm. And so that was all moving. And then all of a sudden, the guys that are way ahead at the DOD top level, CAPE, the Secretary of Defense, etc., the deputy sec, felt that there was other priorities that needed to be funded more than this radar for Hawaii.
Okay, a lot of people want to know, and what did this have to do with the ball? Remember, we always talk about the ball coming in, coming out. Right. And that, at a point in time, was to be out there deployed far away as I'm keeping an eye on you.
So for Hawaii, we have a couple things that we do. Mm-hmm. We have space-based sensor radars that can detect the launch, and we have a Tippy 2 radar in Japan that can pick up the first part of that launch as it discriminates, as it expands out. And then we lose the track, so we have to have that SBX out at a specific location to be able to use its very, it's got soda straw to be able to
little
target.
Piece of the pie, we call it.
And that was the radar that we were using for the defense of Hawaii. So that, as you know, is in and out of the port. That also has to be our testing radar. That also has to do other missions. And especially with hypersonics and the development that we're doing has allocated elsewhere, and it's very expensive to operate.
Yeah.
So that was the reason, and it's older technology.
I was going to say, it's kind of aging in place, right? So, I mean, what's its benefit at this point? Is it going to even
still be used? Well, it's still a test radar. Yeah, so yeah. We're going to be testing a lot of stuff, and it's got to be in position to be tested.
Which is going to be close at hand.
Right.
I mean, it's not going to go on these deployments thousands of miles away anymore.
Right.
It looks like, anyway.
But... So you're reliant on that, and they know where that ball is. Everybody knows where the ball is.
Sure.
So that we try to get out of that, and plus we had new technology that was able to pick up much better discrimination on the targets, and was able to deliver that to different weapon systems. So that now is not there. So we're taking a risk right now, and then you add to this that we were supposed to do 64 big ground-based interceptors up in Alaska to defend all of the United States. We didn't do it. We stopped the production of that because we wanted to go another direction. Yeah. So we only have 44 of them.
Yeah, and you know what? Wait a minute. Everybody, you learned in previous times and gave me some pretty valuable feedback when we had Riki on in the past, and that was, you know, you can see all of this stuff, but what you have to have is a piece of equipment that can go out and knock it down. And you only have so many of those.
Right.
You know?
And out of the 44, there are three generations. So the first ones aren't as good as the last ones there. And now you've got to worry about defending the 48 with the big cities and the big population centers. And how many of those do you want to give to Hawaii? Mm-hmm. So that's why you wanted Hawaii to have a self-sufficient capability just in case those guys don't want to spend those missiles on you. That you have your own capability and your own radar that can do this. And that was the genesis of why we did this.
You know, Stacy says, isn't that what happened in the very beginning? We do all of the testing and the results go somewhere else. How many missiles do we have, defense missiles, do we have that we can launch from Hawaii? That's always been a question. Ever since we met and first started talking about
this. We've always asked to be able
to have something here in the backyard.
And I think that is coming. So I think they are testing this new missile that's on Aegis ships that we co-produced with Japan against an ICBM this year. So you will have the first capability of that. And I'm sure that this missile would certainly be available to Hawaii in the islands on that.
So in some
respects... But that still needs a radar.
I was going to say, in some respects, okay, great, we got it. But what about the radar to support how we're going to use it?
Right, so now we've got to come up with another solution. You can't not have a radar here. So you're either going to force the SPX to do this every day, or you're going to create a solution. This is the best solution, but now you're going to take risks. You can take a 40% solution off this, or 60% release. So that's what they've got to figure. That's what you should be demanding.
Well,
here's the thing. Should be demanding.
Exactly.
And what is the solution?
And when we talk about demanding, it's to our delegation. Our delegation ought to be speaking for us. And here's already everybody wants to know, and Dennis wants to know this, and so do I. Is there valuable information on your website that can give people a look at this? Because a lot of people here feel kind of you know, helpless. They don't know who to turn to or where to get the scoop from, and then in fact how to turn around and ask their reps or their congressperson, hey, look, what about this stuff? You're going to take care of us with this.
No, that information, you can look it up on the internet, Wikipedia, you can go to our website, but it's there. It's now the resolve of your federal delegation to put pressure on, because Congress now gets to chip in on this budget and say, hey, let's look at this. Let's relook at this. Let's put money back in to be able to get this, our state, more defended. That's what you got
to
do.
I was going to say, it sounds to me like we have to reach out. Some of our delegation has to reach across the table. They got to learn how to work with each other. That all of the pork and stuff that our delegation wants for Hawaii would be augmented by getting partners on the mainland who would help us out defensively.
Yeah.
And that's not happening right now.
This is a gap filler because eventually we talked about they're going to get space up there that's going to be able to see everything. But we don't have that capability, not probably for a decade at the earliest. So this is something that I think is very urgent because North Korea hasn't stopped producing ICBMs. Iran is firing ballistic missiles, got out of the nuclear agreement. So that threat's coming to the United States. So those 44... are not going to be able to do everything.
Yeah, and there's one more thing before we go to our news break, and that is explain that, you know, a lot of this is once you've developed the carrier, in other words, the missile the warhead and the payload and all, that's another discussion. But once you have the ability to deliver your mayhem, now you're really, Iran's really a force that needs to be reckoned with.
Right. But you've got to track it. Yeah, I mean, if you can't see it,
gotta look at it. Yeah.
If you can't see it, you can't shoot it down. Yeah. You can have the best shooters in the world, but if you can't see it coming, you can't shoot it down. So that that was the critical part of this on the end game, was identifying what those missiles are and all the countermeasures and which missile to go target and have capability. That's the critical thing.
And it used to be good luck making any of that stuff work, but now with all of this testing, the stuff works. Now all we have to do is acquire it. It's 6:31. More coming up with Riki Ellison, but right now it's time to catch our 6:30 report.
Now, here's more of the Mike Buck Show on AM 690 and FM 94.3. The Answer.
Okay, one thing I like about Riki Ellison is that he's a half-full glass guy. He's not a half-empty glass guy. And he's used to fighting from behind, not only athletically as he did as a, you know, Super Bowl guy, but now in the Missile Defense Advocacy Alliance. And in case you wondered, he's in the Polynesian Hall of Fame, Athletic Hall of Fame. And we're going to talk a little bit about that and a little bit about the YIP in a minute. But it all sort of dovetails into one of the main reasons why Riki is here and here as often as he is. Not just because he loves us and the weather and helping kids, but we are at the closest point to the bad guys as anybody in the country. And every time you come here, people get jacked up to make sure that we're getting what we deserve. In an ideal world, what do we need to try and talk somebody into saying, would you please take a second look at this radar thing if we need it? Do we need it?
You definitely need it. So you definitely need, if you can't do this, you're going to have another solution that's here on island.
What's plan B?
That releases SPX capability. So plan B can be a variety of things. Mm-hmm. Plan B can be just putting a new radar at PRMF that may be not as great as the LRDR. Plan B can be putting a Tippy 2 radar on Kauai. Plan B can be putting remote radars that can float on ships, remote radars that can be connected to PRMF. PRMF's Aegis Ashore site, the facility there is a command and control that can link into the ships and do engage on remote, launch on remote from these ships. So you have a baseline.
There's a lot of ways, a lot of plan Bs.
But the generals and the admirals have to make that decision on what that solution is. But they've got to be given the money and the authority by Congress to do that.
Okay, so right now, speaking about money, the defense of our country has been really enhanced and augmented by the biggest appropriation ever for defense spending, rather than offensive spending, right? So we're happy about this.
We're happy about the $20.3 billion,
right?
But we're happy because we're going into space. Mm. We're going into hypersonic offensive strike. We're doing left of launch and right of launch. Mm. And the whole thing about this is about, we're never going to go to war. Hopefully, we'll never go to war.
But
to deter and to stop the other guys from using those weapon systems, negating those weapon systems, so we can stabilize it and we can go negotiate.
You know, here's something interesting. Francis says, are there any other places in the country where there are cultural problems as well with regards to some of this equipment? That's really a great question because, as you know, right here, we're going through a lot of things right now with cultural things.
Right.
And there are some people that are looking at part of this issue as being a cultural issue rather than anything else.
I believe that we don't need to look at new bases. We got current bases all over the country and all over
our
territory.
Everywhere. Yeah.
That have already done the studies, done the cultural sensitivity, done the environmental impact. Instead of trying to create a new site, just go to
which is where this was going, right? Yeah, they're looking at new properties.
So you've got PRMF, you've got all the sites all culturally accepted and environmental studies done, and it's cheaper, quicker, easier to do that. And something like that. I mean, your technology, because you're not as high as higher up in the mountain that you'd like to be. You can see more, a little bit more, but still, I think that's an issue that we've got to think through, and we've got to use what we've already got done instead of wasting that time and effort.
Yeah, I'm truly
hoping to beat those cultural issues, which they need to be on their own. I agree with you. There's no reason we should be doing stuff on cultural burial sites at all.
Yeah, I mean, of all people that know that, you're a Maori.
Absolutely, this is exactly
what's happened in New Zealand, right?
The sacredness of certain sites, of where we've come from, and keeping that holy and keeping that you know, clean. That's absolutely correct. We can do this in other places.
It's my hope that those that are emotionally attached to, say, the Mauna Kea movement and the meat, everything that's really been the Hawaiian causes have been lifted to a new level in the last decade that we've never seen before. I hope that it's not confusion as to what's what. I mean, looking, you know, putting a telescope on Mauna Kea and having a radar on Kauai are two different pots of everything.
But the technology, we are evolving to doing stuff remotely on the oceans, on ships, on platforms, in space, so and sites that we already have.
Right.
So that's, you know,
what I'm saying is, what you said just a few minutes ago, just so people get it clear. This was a new project. It was going to be something new. It was going to be, you know, a new construction somewhere. And what you said is, we can do the same thing where we already are.
Yeah, that's what they said. They shifted. When they found out they couldn't do it, they shifted to
PRMF. Exactly.
Because that's already been regulated to do it. Now, the question with PRMF is that's one of our greatest testing sites that we have in the world.
And you folks on Kauai, bless you all, because, boy, you're contributing to not just our defense, but the whole country's defense.
Right, and this radar would not shut down the operations of the testing, and it would be queued up when something bad happens. Mm-hmm. But you really need to be able to distinguish what's coming at you and seeing what's coming at you so you can defend against it.
One of the things that everybody learns whenever we talk is the ability to know when something leaves the ground heading our way, no matter what part of the world it's in, how quickly we know that's happening. And so, but knowing what's happening and being able to knock it down are two different things, right? We can do both.
Take a look at what Iran did when they fired ballistic missiles at our bases last month, okay? So we didn't have missile defense capabilities there.
Right.
They targeted those bases because they didn't have missile defense capabilities. But we knew as soon as that thing lit up, within 5 seconds, we were able to move that information to that base for those soldiers to get underground and stabilize themselves.
What a way to live. Right.
On that, to take the hit. That's passive defense. So that's what happened there. So we definitely have the ability to know when the first initial.
In some respects, was that actually, I don't want to say anything's a good thing, but was that partially a good thing in that it served as a grim reminder of where we are? Once we know that that's what these guys did, they could have done a lot more. They could have done a lot, you know, a lot more devastating stuff with some sort of an attack. But didn't this point out to us that, hey, we can get you as big as you are, the U.S.? We can, we're little guys, but we can get you?
Yep, and they demonstrated that, and they shot from 600-700 miles, which meant they could reach all of our bases.
Yeah, and that's right now, by the way.
All of our bases.
Tell people how fast.
In the Middle East on that. They demonstrated that. They demonstrated their accuracy, which was less than 10 meters where they struck, and they struck
precisely. Was that
kind of
a surprise?
That's a surprise for a lot of how accurate they were. Yeah. They were flexing their muscles, and they bring in the cruise missile threat, which they were using as well earlier last year when they shot down the Saudi Arabian oil refinery. So if you bring all that together, that's a complicated offensive capability that projects power, and that's what they're using.
And let me tell you, gang, this is something I learned from Riki a long time ago. When we first started these discussions, which are really, to me, very fruitful and meaningful to everybody out there listening. When we started these discussions, most of the countries that we were worried about had these little scud things. I mean, they couldn't hit their feet, you know. But now, you know, another 10 years has gone by, and, hey, these guys have gotten their act together, and they've taken oil
with
money.
Cruise,
and they've spent a lot of money, and they've,
And again, it's the poor man's way to project power.
Sure.
Iran's gotten away with it. North Korea's getting away with it, and they're negotiating with the President of the United States.
Yeah, so you don't need...
That works for them. It works. They didn't get blown up when they fired ballistic missiles at us.
By the way, gang, it's
a strategy that's working for these countries to compete.
And the thing is, gang, you don't need an aircraft carrier. And you know, 5,000 guys or bomber planes or anything else. You just need to have a silo somewhere.
Right. And they didn't go to war. So they set an example to everybody. So everybody's doing it. Everybody's creating power to ballistic missiles, cruise missiles, to be able to intimidate us.
What's the light at the end of the tunnel? You'll find out in a minute. And also, in a minute, you're going to find out what's happening in the YIP program, which I love. And something new with the new UH coach carrying on this program, which is good news for Riki and all of his gang and all of y'all that have kids that need a little special attention. That's all coming up. But right now, time to take a look at traffic with Tyzo Braden.
Now, back to Mike on AM 690 and FM 94.3. The Answer.
Okay, so the Rocket Man. And I love it because it's always a two-edged sword. And Riki and I, once we get rolling on this stuff, we can just go on and on and on. But it wouldn't be fair if we didn't also give you a little bit of the other side. Back in the day, Riki came up with an idea, part of his foundation, with his YIP, Youth in Peril Project, and it moved over and it osmosed into Hawaii, which is one of Ricky's favorite places. And in the last couple of years, we've had just great fun with Coach Rolovich and a lot of the folks, with Mufi Hanneman, with everybody in the tourism industry, with Chef Roy, with you and everything. It's just been wonderful and terrific. And knock on wood, new coach, new ball, passing the baton, we're keeping going.
It's awesome.
That's so exciting.
We had a great meeting with the Center Ron Coachee, and the athletic director, Dave, as well as Todd Graham, the new coach. So, and
by the way, when he says Coachee, that means that we're going to be starting to look at kids on the neighbor islands, right, and particularly the Kauai, which is his neck of the woods. It's not because we didn't want to do that before, but it was just...
The program wasn't mature enough to handle it. Now we're looking to reach out to the islands to have them come over to be participants of this, to spread that love and spread that education out.
You know, Riki, for people that don't know what that is, YIP, tell us a little bit. First of all, what is it, and what gave you not only the idea to develop it, but let's talk about how successful it is in other places, not just here in Hawaii.
Well, it's been in 34 different universities. It's with
nationwide,
5,000 young boys. But the whole focus is on that 10 to 12-year-old shaping of a young... Right now, a young boy, we want to get to the girls, but we're right now on the young boy and getting him and lighten up his passion for education, his passion for life, and exposing him to the university campus in his community and surrounding him with leadership, with student athletes that were almost 4 years removed from the same place, military soldiers and Marines, same age, and we break them up in groups of 25, and we put them in classrooms, and they go through a university academic day.
Yeah, and these are kids.
For 10 days.
This is unbelievable. For 10 days.
And we put them in mathematics, English, science, and the scores escalate.
Which is the whole deal.
Yeah, I mean, because we control the classroom.
I don't want to say it's bait and switch, but a lot of these kids in the beginning thought, oh, wow, Riki Ellison. Oh,
well, we give them clothes. We give them food, free food from our best restaurant. Yeah. But we treat them like kings, and we give them that positive experience at a university setting
to
change their lives.
And what's happened since this started, these young men are becoming, not just athletes, but scholars. And what's really interesting is you've taken some of the kids that come from some of the toughest places and turned them on to a loving being educated. I mean, it must be just...
We've got success stories. We've got kids, they've got academic scholarships at Punahou and some of the private schools that we've pulled out. But we want them to go back into their schools and lead by the discipline they've gotten, by the passion of what can happen if you get educated.
Somebody asked, Roger asked, I've heard you and Riki talking about this before. How does somebody qualify for that, and how do where do these young people come from? That's a great question.
So we're limited by the facilities of the University of Hawaii, which we can only take 120 boys.
Yep.
So it's first come, first serve on this. Mm-hmm. We haven't got the dates yet. We're going to get that date set, but the website is number one. We're pulling from Honolulu right now in the districts here. We have bus stops to pick them up. So it's really the first 120 that sign up. And we're going to go a little bit more than that because there is an attrition rate.
Sure.
But it's open. And we are obviously targeted to kids that need this the most. Yeah. But we're not going to reject anybody that wants to do this.
Yeah, and you know what it is? It's a pebble in the pond. That's what I really so love about this program. And now that it's been going for a while, not only are some kids... Look at every single kid throwing a ball around in the yard thinks they're going to play for the NFL, right? Yeah. And that's their whole focus. And from what I understand, this program has leveled them out to say, yeah, it would be nice to play football in high school and college, but there's a little bit more to life than playing football.
So much more. And the dynamics of these student athletes that are on football squads having some of the similar problems. Yeah. Similar problems as
been
the
there,
young,
done that. I love
right?
that. Hey, wait. There's one that moved me, and you know, I mean, I try not to get emotional about stuff, but there's one thing that really moved me, and there was this kid, this giant of a kid, a couple of years back. This big kid, big strapping guy, and he had like a size 15 foot or something.
16, 17.
And this guy, talk about getting lit up. They gave him a pair of shoes, Riki. First time in his life, this monster had a pair of shoes. I've never seen a bigger smile in my life.
Tears rolling
down his face and a big old smile. Yeah. Why me, Lord? Why me? I thought that was great.
And we unified it. This is unifying all the different races right? I mean, this is a melting pot of Asian, Pacific Islanders, Caucasians, everybody's here, and we're able to melt it, and we're able to create trust. Because that's the biggest issue with our country, is the lack of trust in the social injustice. There's lack of trust with the inner city and the institution, and we're trying to bring that trust and bring that bridge to build that up.
This is interesting, this guy has no idea what we're going to talk about next, but Bill wants to know how it is where you come from in New Zealand with missile defense. You're going to New Zealand, Riki, and I mean, you know, let me tell you something. New Zealand raised the bar about a lot of things a long time ago. There were some things that they just didn't want to have anything to do with, and they became sort of pretty isolated. Yeah. And I know some of that's changed, but it's still a no nuke.
I think they've reestablished the relationship with the United States Navy.
I don't mean that.
There was no nuke with Ronald Reagan back in the day.
Yeah. None.
Yeah. Yeah. But let me just step back and say to you that everything in the Southern Hemisphere doesn't seem to be warlike. Mm-hmm. We have all our major problems where I go is all Northern Hemisphere. Mm-hmm. And certainly New Zealand is not targeted by any major power in the world.
Knock on wood.
So if you want to be somewhere safe,
there you go.
You can go right there. They don't need it. Nobody wants to take over New Zealand. So I think
great food, great lamb, everything, all the good stuff.
And they speak English. So,
And yet it's sort of interesting because aren't they kind of a lot like us? I mean, you know, what brought you here to Hawaii and everything else and so many...
The Polynesian part of it, the Maori part of it. In fact, I'm going back to honor my dad and the Marae and Takao to give him that cultural perspective.
Yeah, and that means... So you're off to there right now. Doesn't everybody want to know? And by the way, before we get booted out of here with time, let's talk really quickly because not only is Riki, you know, just... wowed him for years and years athletic, but you got a son that is like following in your footsteps. He's gonna go right by you. How's Red doing?
Because he got on the concussion protocol at the end of the season. So those are things that we didn't have in our game, where they've really helped with the safety of the game. Yeah. So he's evaluating that aspect of it. But he's in his ninth year, I believe, still with the New York Giants, and has the opportunity to play again if he wants to play.
Yeah, good for him, and good for you. Coming up next, what's next? You're going to be back here when?
I'll be back here in April. We're going to host the Pacific Missile Defender of the Year, the best guys. Yeah. We elevate and recognize across the services and across our Pacific nations the excellence of this mission. So we're going to do that April 10th. Here in Hollywood.
What's really important about that is Riki goes all over these places, and some of them are, you think we're isolated? These guys are isolated, and they have a one-track mind. They get up every day to protect us and to defend us.
Okinawa, Korea, Japan,
Alaska.
The Middle East is particularly. But it's important for us to recognize, because again, you go to the Super Bowl, they recognize Patrick Mahomes. They don't recognize the Kansas City defense. I didn't see anybody recognizing anybody.
I'm spoken like a true defender.
And I think they kind of won the game because they're the ones that shut down San Francisco. But we want to bring that up, and we also want to cross and create trust between our allies with this and across the services in this domain, because as you see with the budget, money talks.
Yeah.
When you spend $20.3 billion and you increase your budget by almost 50%, this is a serious issue.
People
and
waking
a
up.
Serious mission that we think is going to make our world and our country safer. So that's where we're going, and we're trying to build that momentum and get this stuff in place, get it deployed, operational, and make all of our states as safe as possible.
Boy, I tell you, that's
Hawaii, number one.
And you delegation, you better do this. People want to know more.
www.missiledefenseadvocacy.org.
Just search missile
or me, Riki Ellison.
Pleasure to see you, my friend. We'll see you again soon. Okay. Aloha. It is 6:59 bit. 7 o'clock is coming up. We're going to talk a little bit about homelessness, and then later on talk about the Align with Veterans program with Tony D. It's all right here on The Answer. We'll be right back.